Hello, and welcome to another edition of Seen Anything Good Lately. I'm Jason Solomons, and this is the show that channels all the passion people have for sharing what they're watching, how they want to enthuse you with the same excitement of discovery and entertainment they've just had. And my guests and I should know, I've been a film critic for 25 years in British national newspapers, on radio and on TV. And what does everyone ask me? Seen anything good lately, Jace? So now it's my turn to switch it back on you and find out what they've been watching and what it tells us about them.
I have a real love of horror films. It's kind of a private pleasure because no one else in my family will watch horror films. I love this.
I watched a documentary series called Dynasty.
You heard there from my guests this week. They are the best-selling author and screenwriter and telemaster David Nicholls, whose adaptation of his own book Us is now on BBC iPlayer. And you heard from Yemi Bamiro, a new star of the London doc-making scene, whose first film, One Man and His Shoes, just debuted at the London Film Festival to great acclaim. We'll find out more about what they've been up to and what they've been watching. But before we hear from David Nicholls and Yemi Bamiro, oh, I just can't resist it. I'll tell you if I've seen anything good lately. I saw Pixar's new film, Soul. It was supposed to have been at Cannes earlier this year, but it premiered at the London Film Festival. So I saw it on the big screen before it goes on to enchant the world on Christmas Day, but on the small screen, making its bow on Disney Plus, the streaming platform. Yeah, that is controversial and a shame for the gorgeous visuals that Pixar just do better and better with each movie. This one features also their first African-American cast in many skin tones, and it's about jazz, or one man's obsession with jazz, and the night that he gets his big shot playing at the Half Note Club in the city, he has a brush with death and gets whisked off to the great beyond, where he drifts about with lost souls and new souls before finding the meaning of life.
Huh? Is this heaven?
No, it's the great before. This is where new souls get their personalities, quirks, and interests before they go to Earth.
Meet 22.
I don't want to go to Earth.
Stop fighting this.
I don't want to.
It's a very complicated and ambitious cartoon, is Soul. Great to look at, zingy and funny, with Jamie Foxx and Tina Fey as the lead voices. But the concept does get the better of it, I found. Lots of people swooned over it, but I do find Pixar movies so honed and polished, so worked out, that there's little room for anything that feels spontaneous or improvised, which is a shame given that we're talking about jazz here. It aims high and it seeks philosophy and emotion, but for me, it remained glib and a bit stuck in the motivational quote realm to be a true masterpiece. But I'm very picky here. You'll love Soul on Christmas Day on Disney Plus. What a treat and a real event on TV to unite the whole family, like Morecambe and Wise used to do. David Nicholls is a best-selling author whose books include Starter for 10 and One Day, and they've both been turned into successful movies that I would call romantic and comic, but aren't exactly rom-coms. His book Us was longlisted for the Booker Prize, and now David, who has previously dashed off great screenplays for such trivial things as Great Expectations, adapts his own novel into a four-part TV series, telling the story of Douglas Peterson, played by a superb Tom Hollander, whose wife Saskia Reeves tells him she wants to leave him, but grimly determined to hang on in denial, Douglas still insists on taking her and his 17-year-old son Albie on a final family holiday, a grand interrailing tour of the great European capitals.
Douglas, I've been thinking about leaving. I think our marriage might be over.
Ah, so trial separation?
Except not a trial.
What can I change about myself?
We should still go on holiday. We'll have this last summer together.
3 weeks, 6 countries, 12 cities were like, I don't know, you too.
I loved watching the series as much as I enjoyed reading the book. The TV's bittersweet tone and performances toggle between sharp, painful comedy and truthful, emotional observations, bringing all the deceptive skill of the book's writing flooding back to me as I watched it. So when I spoke to David Nicholls, I began by asking him what, for him, the key difference was between the page and the screen.
Yeah, I mean, the novel I wrote 10 years ago, or started writing 10 years ago. And so it's a long, long journey. When I was writing the novel, I thought, God, what must it feel like to be 53? And of course, now time has come, rushed towards me and met me. And now I know. No, it's been great, actually. It's always daunting adapting your own work because you don't want to upset people. And you know that people are going to say, some people are going to say, oh, it's not as good as the book. But actually, in this case, if people have said anything, they've said the opposite, which is, you know, hurtful in its own way.
I tell you what I thought. I thought what I loved about the series is that it brought the book flooding back to me because there's a little gap between having read the book and seeing the characters. And I'd forgotten the complexities, the time shifts, the nuances of the book. And I thought that all came back. And that was, I thought, a delight.
When you sort of populate a book like that, the novel is written from his point of view and you're always in his head. And it gets slightly claustrophobic because he has a very particular view of the world. But when you have actors populating it and inhabiting the characters, suddenly it becomes much more 3D and fleshed out, and perhaps the characters become a bit more sympathetic than they do on the page where you have the relentless first-person voice. So that's been interesting to me as well. I mean, there are changes, and there are a lot of really nice jokes in the book that you just can't put on screen because he thinks them, he doesn't say them. But you just have to accept that that's what you lose, and what you gain is performance, and not just performance, but settings and design and music and editing and all of those other pleasures.
Tom Hollander as Douglas in Us, I mean, I think he's terrific, and I've known him for a long time. I presume you have. He's one of those actors who's been around in the 90s. I think it's one of the best I've ever seen him be as Douglas in your
Yes,
your
he's
adaptation.
Amazing. And again, you know, all of those things that you think must be in the script are in his face, and he provides all the kind of poignancy behind the lines, and you don't need to give him a big monologue. He can just do it. And that's been a real privilege. And I've been very, very lucky with the actors I've worked with. A lot of people I've admired for years and years. So it's a thrill to see them bring things to life.
David, it's great to have your Us up there and out there. I mean, I really enjoyed the mood of it and the look of it and how it went around Europe. And it just made me think, gosh, we used to be able to travel. It feels like almost like a relic from another era when we're talking now in this kind of looming lockdown times.
Yes, it's heartbreaking, isn't it? We were meant to broadcast the show in May. It was meant to be ready for then. And of course, we couldn't quite finish post-production. And I think in May, it would have felt actually just too much, you know, everyone desperate to leave the country for the summer and not being able to. And still now it feels tantalizing. You know, I'd love to spend an afternoon in Paris or Barcelona or at all museums. You know, we didn't make it with that intention at all. I mean, if we had an anxiety during production, it was Brexit and how that was going to affect the broadcast.
Oh, well, don't worry, that's going to be happening soon as well.
So. Any second now. But yeah, I think when we were a little nervous that people would resent the fact that you're having their kind of noses rubbed in all these amazing cities. It was always meant also to be a kind of love letter to these places. Mm. Even though Douglas has a horrible time, we did want the backdrop to be sumptuous and beautiful, to be realistic about what it's like to travel and how stressful it can be and demanding on a relationship, but also to make Venice and Paris and Barcelona look beautiful.
I'm wondering what when you were writing it or when you write, if there are any influences on you as a writer or as a screenwriter or, you know, indeed in your head as a director. So I'm going to ask you if you've seen anything good lately, David Nicholls, and we'll find out what's impacting on you.
Well, we should start with film, shouldn't we?
Yeah.
Well, I've been to the cinema twice in the last 3 weeks.
Oh, good for you.
First time for ages, and loved the experience both times. Two very different British films. But, you know, in this vacuum that's been left by Hollywood, a lot of really wonderful new British independent films are finding space. And the first film I saw was Rocks, which I loved and found incredibly powerful, directed by Sarah Gavin, written by Teresa Ikoko and Claire Wilson. And it's in many ways a very classic piece of British social realism in that Ken Loach tradition. And if you were to hear a synopsis of it, you might think, God, that sounds a bit tough, a bit sort of play for today. But actually, it's so joyous and truthful and humane and poignant, but also uplifting, about teenage friendship, about characters rarely portrayed on screen, and they're given real depth and treated with such warmth and portrayed with great humanity and detail by the young actors. And I thought it was just a really joyous, uplifting film.
I did too. We had those people you mentioned on the show, Sarah and Claire and Teresa, and what a collaboration it seemed and was. In a way, you write screenplays almost quite traditional compared to what they've concocted, this looseness that you feel, like how much on that is on the page, it must be left open to chance. You know, there's so much sort of fly on the wall camera work and music. Yeah. It's a super cool film, I thought.
Yeah, I mean, I was, as a writer, I was fascinated by that process. I tend to write dialogue that's quite kind of arch, I suppose. It feels written, and that's just how I write. You can tell that the movie is, you know, has a structure and there are scenes, but the dialogue, whether it's written or improvised, is just so natural and so truthful. And I felt, to me, really raw without ever feeling grim or po-faced or pious. And I love that about it.
Do you like that tradition, that British social realist tradition?
Yeah, I really do. You know, I'm a kind of child of Play for Today, Mike Lee, Trevor Griffiths and Jack Rosenthal and all of those extraordinary plays that I stayed up late to watch. I didn't go to the theatre at all until I was sort of 18, 19. There was no theatre to see, really.
And where were you growing up?
A small town called Eastleigh, which is near Southampton. Mm. And Southampton had a very good repertory theatre, but I didn't really go except on kind of school trips. So Play for Today was the nearest I got to exciting new writing and acting. And this, I could see, comes from that tradition, but makes it feel really, really fresh and a really lovely cinema experience as well. I went to see it in Crouch End, and the cinema was as full as it can be in these days. And everyone was very moved by it. So it was a great reintroduction to the pictures.
Yeah, it's interesting that you say that, you know, the absence of Hollywood product, which a lot of people sort of saying, oh, no, that's closing all the cinemas down. But you're right, it's giving some British films the exposure that it's getting in the press and in terms of advertising, in terms of shows like this. They're talking, I think you've been to see another film that includes a guest of mine in Morfydd Clark.
Morfydd, I've worked with Morfydd. She was in Patrick Melrose, quite a small part. I wish it had been bigger because she's an extraordinary actress. And this is St. Maud, directed by and written by Rose Glass, a new director. And I have a real love of horror films. It's kind of a private pleasure because no one else in my family will watch horror films. I love this. And, you know, found it. I came home after seeing it and Hannah, my partner, said, what was it like? And I said, it was absolutely terrifying. And she just looks at me bemused as to why would you put yourself
this is a good thing?
Something so grueling and upsetting. But I thought it was wonderful. And again, very much part of a tradition. It reminded me of Dennis Potter's Brimstone and Treacle in the way that it dealt with.
Yes, good reference.
And the kind of seediness of provincial small towns in the rain and had the same sense of creeping evil and discomfort. And Morfydd is amazing in it. Jennifer Ely, who I think is a wonderful actor.
We don't see her enough, do we?
No, not nearly enough. I thought she was just really charismatic and powerful. And it is not for everyone. You know, I did find it genuinely distressing in places.
When I was speaking to Morfydd on the show, I'd completely forgotten that it's actually set now. It seemed to me that it was set, I don't know, 70s or 80s or something. And Morfydd said, oh no, she's got millennial fears. I see her very much as a millennial. And I was thinking, blimey, God, I didn't even occur to me that it was like here and now. But of course it is.
Yeah, it's set in Scarborough, isn't it? And they make it look kind of brilliantly kind of run down and sad. I mean, I love Scarborough. It's no offense to Scarborough, but they've clearly gone out of their way to make it seem kind of damp and mildewy, and it has a fantastic atmosphere. And yeah, as you say, it sort of has that. It reminded me a lot of British horror from the 70s. That's like the griminess of it that's part of the unease. And I thought it was really fascinating about religion and sex and the strange business of caring for someone and how that can go horribly wrong. So I found it very powerful and full of not just Rose Glass, the director and writer, but in every department, there were brilliant new names attached to this movie. I loved it.
Yeah, do you think that British cinema's in a good spot? I mean, it's hard to say right now because the economics of the world have taken over in a way. But that let's say that was shot last year, won an award at the London Film Festival, the IWC award. So it felt to me that with those two films that you know, those are really fine British films, female-led, female-directed and written and produced, that we're in a very interesting new spot in terms of films.
I think there are lots sort of in the cupboard waiting to come out that are really wonderful, but the fact that production has sort of ground to a halt and all these people who rely on, you know, turning up on set for their livelihood, I think they're in a tough place. And I do really feel for them. I hope we can start making things again. And I hope that, you know, that the these new faces, new directors, new writers will have a showcase in the cinemas. I hope the cinemas survive. So if you can, go and see it in a real cinema and you feel comfortable doing so.
Yeah. Strangely, very quickly, Rock's got onto Netflix. And I don't know if that's what... Are you a Netflix family? What do you and your kids and your wife watch at home?
It's strange because I'm a, you know, as I was saying, I'm of that generation that looks at the TV schedules. And yes. My kids don't understand the concept.
Back of the paper, or Radio Times.
They don't understand the concept of a TV schedule. And they do think in terms of, you know, channels. It's just that their channels are Netflix and Amazon and BBC and Sky. And, you know, they don't have that same fixed notion. In many ways, it's very healthy. They love watching stuff. They love consuming stuff, but they don't stumble upon things in the way I did when I was their age. You know, they're not made to watch things, and there's a danger that they kind of settle into a groove and just look for the same kind of shows over
yes.
and over again rather than...
So what do you do in this instance? You sort of go around and sort of say, can't you watch something good for you?
We have two or three evenings where they have to, you know, put their phones down and we watch a proper film mm-hmm. all the way through.
Such as?
Checking out films. We're currently watching American Animals, which is a film for production from a couple of years ago based on a true story, which I'm really, really enjoying. That's the other thing, is their attention span means it's quite hard to get through anything over.
That's a difficult film, American Animals. It's not a brilliant film, but it's
a brilliant film, very interesting film. My son is enjoying it. My daughter is allowed to go on her phone during that, because she's a bit younger and it's a bit more mature, but we're really enjoying that. And so, yeah, we have two or three evenings of proper watching during the week, and also they have their own private passions which they're allowed to go off and watch themselves.
Your daughter is named after one of my favorite French movie stars.
Yes.
Romy Schneider. Does she know that, and has she had to watch some Romy films?
She knows what Romy Schneider looks like, and we haven't found anything yet in the Romy Schneider catalog that's quite right for her, but we will. But yeah, there are pictures of Romy Schneider around the house. But
that's very cool. I mean, has French cinema always been an interest to you and an inspiration to you?
Yeah, massively. I mean, I've stolen a lot in particular from Truffaut, you know, from the 400 Blows and the other, and what are they called?
Antoine Doinel.
And the Antoine Doinel books, which Antoine Doinel films, which, you know, follow a young man at different stages of his life. Those films are very, very influential. I love Eric Rohmer. Our big Saturday night movie was Robert Bresson's A Man Escaped, which is a film I've seen many, many times and really, really love. So, yeah, French classic, French art house cinema is something
I should stress that to our listeners that you are dressed in a sort of French black polo neck.
Put it on.
I'm sure you've got an ashtray overflowing with gauloises at the side. There you go. It's complete. Just before you go, David, fantastic recommendations there. Have you read anything good lately?
Yeah, I've very quickly, because I'm very passionate about both these books, particularly this novel. I've just finished a novel by Andrew Hagen called Mayflies, which starts as this kind of account of a gang of kind of working class Glaswegian kids in the 80s going to Manchester for a music festival. And the first half of the novel is this kind of rambunctious, outrageous sort of Trainspotting-esque kind of mad trip to Manchester, and to the ending in the Hacienda, a kind of celebration of youth.
Oh, wow. I fancy this.
Politics, and it's great. But then something happens halfway through, which I can't tell you. But the second half of the book is written in a completely different register and is incredibly tender and poignant about friendship and friendship over time. I found the book intensely moving and beautifully written and really brilliant about the strength of friendship and the difference between friendship when you're 18 and 50.
So Andrew Hagen, a former film critic as well, so I always like to see
how
he's gone.
It's shot through with film and cultural references in the way that you do when you're that age and you want to, you know, shout out loud about the books and films and music you love. So it's a really wonderful novel, very affecting, very funny, and the best book I've read this year, I think. I really loved it.
Well, stick that on the jacket cover.
Oh, yeah. I'd be honoured. It's a really wonderful book, and I felt very jealous of it, actually, if anything.
So it's Andrew Hagen's Fireflies.
Mayflies. A really beautiful book, I think. And then I try not to read fiction just before I fall asleep because I get too het up. Before I turn the light out at night, I always read a piece of nonfiction. I'm really enjoying an unconventional biography of Mike Nicholls. You know, when I was watching...
No relation, we should add.
No. I have two L's. He's just a single L. I'd have loved to have met him because The Graduate and Catch-22 and Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf were huge formative influences on me, particularly The Graduate.
Yeah, well, hence the outfit as well.
Yeah, exactly.
But also he was with Nicholls and May, Elaine May. They were a great screwball comic pairing.
Yeah, amazing improvisers, brilliant comic imaginations. And this it's not a conventional biography. It's told in the voices of 150 people who knew him at different stages of his life. So it's a sort of, what's the phrase, an oral account of his work and his methods and his life. And it's incredibly gossipy, full of brilliant anecdotes and really, really entertaining.
Oh, I would love this, but what's it called?
It's called Life Isn't Everything. And yes, it's edited by Ash Carter and Sam Kashner, but it's 150 voices talking about their encounters with Mike Nicholls at different stages of his work.
Well, I mean, he worked with everyone, really. He was all sort of the centre of New Hollywood, in a way, in an easy feeling. He did Primary Colours as well, if you go later in his career. Hollywood voice.
There's a very funny story of Harrison Ford saying he was invited to his birthday party, and Mike said it's just a few people, and he turned up and there were 800 people, and Harrison Ford said the only person who wasn't there was Jesus. So it's very star-studded as well, and incredibly entertaining, and that's my little treat before I go try to go to sleep.
Well, brilliant. Life is much more than everything. It's been brilliantly captured by you in your book, in all your books, and beautifully done so in Us as well, certainly A Late Life. Thank you for running through all those recommendations for us, David Nicholls. A real pleasure to see you. I don't know, in between watching all these films and reading all these books, you've got to go and write a screenplay. Better go and let you do it.
I better. It's meant to be in a week's time, so I should get to it. But thanks very much, Jason. It's nice to talk to you.
Lovely to see you. Thanks a lot.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
And Us is available to binge watch now. All four episodes are streaming on iPlayer, while the show's mood board of tunes compiled by DJ David Nicholls is up on Spotify, including this gorgeousness from Tracy Thorn. We'll get Yemi Bamiro on in a bit, but what's that you're saying? Oh, you seen anything good lately, Jace? Well, if you insist. I saw One Night in Miami, part of the London Film Festival, directed by Regina King, making her debut as a filmmaker with a powerful, thoughtful, very skillfully done what-if drama about the night in Miami in 1964 that Cassius Clay beat Sonny Liston to win his first heavyweight championship belt and celebrated by talking the night away with his spiritual advisor Malcolm X and his pals the footballer Jim Brown and singer Sam Cooke. All the actors in this are great. Eli Gorey as Clay and Leslie Odom Jr. as Cooke in particular. And the ideas are very strong in the back and forth as they push each other's buttons about blackness and masculinity and how best to influence the world from their positions as black icons.
Yes, yes, Cassius, Marcellus Clay is the new heavyweight champion of the world, boy.
Yes, he is.
And I don't even have a scratch on my face.
Oh, my goodness.
Cash. What's on, Cash?
What?
Cash, what?
Why am I so pretty?
And I'm only 22 years old. There is no way I'm supposed to be this great. Look, Alexander the Great conquered the whole world at the age of 30, and I conquered the world of boxing at 22 without sustaining so much as a scratch.
That's right.
There he goes.
You do the math.
All right.
It's a very enjoyable piece, serious as it may be, written as a play originally by Kemp Powers, who co-wrote the screenplay to, the Pixar movie I talked about earlier, Soul. In the film, Malcolm and Sam do get very heated, cooked even, you could say, but it does lead to Sam writing this masterpiece.
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming.
That's One Night in Miami. And so to Yemi Bamiro now, a South London filmmaker whose debut doc feature is One Man and His Shoes, tracing the success between basketball legend Michael Jordan and his promotion of Air Jordan Nike shoes. From the inception of the shoes to the ads with Spike Lee and the consumer avarice that made kids kill to get their hands on a pair. It's a study of race, consumerism, marketing, 90s hip-hop culture and iconography, and it was definitely one of the best discoveries of the 2020 London Film Festival, as was the man who made it, Yemi Bamiro. What shoes are you wearing? I can't quite see them there, Yemi.
I'm in my house, so I'm not wearing any. I think my wife would be a bit annoyed if I was, wearing any shoes up here, so nothing.
You're clomping around in big basketball. Do you have a collection yourself?
I'm not really a sneakerhead. I do like trainers, and I do have a stupid amount of shoes, but I wouldn't say I'm a sneakerhead.
Have you got more shoes than your wife?
I have.
That is good. That is very manly. You've got to be man enough to have more shoes than one. Well, so why the obsession with the shoes in this movie? Why make a film about shoes, basically?
Initially, I was interested in collectors. I was interested in people that specifically collect Air Jordan sneakers. I'd never seen any films about that. Per se, I'd seen films about sneaker culture or collectors across a number of brands, but I'd never seen anyone that, or any collectors or any long form sort of like documentary on people that specifically collect Air Jordans. So that was like the entry point, I suppose. But then I started thinking about, well, I don't know how interesting that is, and if that sustains sort of like a 90 minute feature length narrative. I kind of thought that, you could see people who collect Air Jordans on YouTube. So then that's when I started to think about the origin story of the Air Jordan sneaker. And I started to think about Nike's relationship with Michael Jordan and sort of like brand endorsement deals, and how 35 years on, nothing has ever eclipsed the relationship from an endorsement impact perspective, from a financial perspective. Nothing's ever eclipsed Nike and Michael Jordan's relationship. So that's pretty much how we ended up with the film.
There's a bit in your film where you talk to some of the collectors, and there's a French guy who sort of says, well I'm an addict, basically. This is an addiction. He suddenly realized that he's addicted to this stuff. And I think that's a really fascinating part of it. And there's another guy whose name I forget. I know you're quite close to him. The guy who said he's got whatever it is, 1,000 pairs, and he keeps them all in those kind of plastic boxes.
He's called Jumpman. His real name's Mark, but he's called Jumpman Bostic. And he's probably one of America's biggest Air Jordan collectors. We filmed him in his basement in just outside of Detroit. And going into his basement is like going into a museum. It's like going back in time, because he doesn't just collect sneakers. He collects anything that was, anything that Michael Jordan marketed. So, the cereal boxes, the Gatorade, he's got the trading cards, the basketball trading cards. He's got like all the Chicago Bulls apparel, the jackets, the jeans. He's got everything. It's incredible. I'm constantly amazed and fascinated by that level of enthusiasm and passion for one thing.
You can understand it that it's for Michael Jordan. Were you a basketball fan yourself? Because, I love watching basketball, but I wouldn't say I know it. I'm a mad Arsenal fan, for example. So
same here.
Get it. You're
good team.
Fantastic. Well, good there we team. Are. So if it was about Ian Wright, for example, to me at the same time was the thing, and he was Nike as well, Ian Wright.
Yeah, exactly.
You try and find an equivalent, but Jordan's just massive. He transcended the sport. We knew even at the time here in the UK how big Michael Jordan was because he had his own sneakers.
Exactly. Yeah. I think I remember being sort of like a teenager in South London going to secondary school and having a Chicago Bulls jacket, and just my friends having Chicago Bulls jacket, just knowing that Michael Jordan and that Bulls franchise was just larger than life. And I think if I think about back to the 90s, I think 90s NBA, that decade is my favorite sort of like decade of any sort of like sports franchise. I think 90s NBA is incredible. Like not just the players and the personalities. I'm talking about just that generation, like what they used to wear off court, like, those incredible suits. I think the music of that time, it's just such a fascinating.
Do you think that's when it all came together as the right culture? I suppose it's been immortalized a bit in The Last Dance suddenly on Netflix, which everyone who comes on this show is watching, it seems. And you've come along just at the right time. And I've got to say, you're not bouncing on that coattail because you were doing this way before then. So that's official, right?
Yeah. No, I think you're right. I think that era and that decade, you know, the 90s was special because I think that was, you know, that was a breakthrough for many things. I think, you know, that's when rap music had its mass market commercial breakthrough, whether you're talking about Eric B and Rakim, if you're talking about MC Hammer, if you're talking about all of, you know, the conscious kind of like hip hop, De La, Tribe, you know, the 90s was just so rich with all of those things. And, you know, it wasn't just the music, it was sort of like African-American personalities. It was like Eddie Murphy, it was Michael Jackson, it was, you know, Michael Jordan. It was all of these fascinating sort of like facets of popular culture.
That's fascinating, isn't it? Because a lot of people in your film talk about selling blackness to white America. That seems to be one of the big battles. And obviously commercially, Michael Jordan had to do that. He had to transcend those barriers as an advertising icon, as a logo, whatever it was. And as you say, you've just enumerated all of those cultural icons, you know, who did break it. You know, the black Elvis was Eddie Murphy. Michael was doing black or white. And it was sort of a flowering time for black power in a way, commercially and artistically.
I remember, because I was born in 83, so I grew up in the 90s. And you just remember all of those things. Me and my sister used to sort of like sit in front of the TV and we used to remember sort of like the MC Hammer sort of like Channel 4 Saturday morning commercial that used to, not even commercial, he had his own cartoon on Saturday mornings and we were obsessed with that. And then Bobby Brown and Whitney Houston, just that, you know, just that era and everything that was sort of like happening. It was seeing people like you on television it just felt like a rarity before that time. It was those are like some of my earliest memories. So, you know, I've always been fascinated with American culture, and that's probably why, because I think in the 90s me and my sister were just like, you know, in a South London flat just like binging on like American pop culture, whether that be music or whether that be TV or whether that be anything else.
This last season, my next guest led his team, the Chicago Bulls, into the NBA playoff scoring record of an amazing 63 points in a single game. He is only 23 years of age. Please welcome Michael Jordan, folks.
I got one thing to say.
Yeah, what's that?
I see Adidas shoes on.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, now, we can't talk about this because the last time we started talking about shoes, there was a huge deal, and they had to run up to the legal department and wake up the attorneys. Now, I know you got a huge contract with the company. Put your feet down. Now, how much do you... No, stop that. Now, they won't let any of this on.
Okay.
Now, how much do you get paid just to wear these shoes?
A lot.
Did you know what it would be like getting access in terms of, you know, you've interviewed some really interesting figures. People say, oh, The Last Dance is great on Netflix because of the access, like the backs, the sort of changing rooms and all that. But you have access to sort of different people. You went for sort of cultural commentators, really interesting and fascinating people who I didn't know at all. I mean, the woman that you get to talk to, I thought she was absolutely brilliant, who talks about it. And then is it Scoop Jackson, which is a great name for journalists.
It's amazing. It's an amazing name.
But they have fantastic insights, fantastic accents. They just got a great jazz to their talk and their insight. How did you track them all down? How did you find these people?
Well, I think it was a long period. I think I started with MJ's biographer, a guy called Rodan Lazenby. He's pretty much written the most definitive book on Michael Jordan, which is called The Life. And he had to speak to everyone. And I interviewed Roland pretty early on in the process. I want to say 2014. We made this film over a 7-year period. And once I'd got in with him and I told him about the project and he'd met me and, you know, I flew all the way out to Virginia to sort of like talk to him. I think he saw the enthusiasm and he saw that, you know, maybe I had the fire in my belly to sort of sit with this and really talk to the people that mattered. That was the thing. I wanted to make a definitive story. So I wanted to talk to the men and women who were around at the time, the people that were responsible for creating this quote unquote phenomenon, like from a shoe perspective, you know, so that'd be like the shoe designers, you know, and this all happened in the late 70s. So this was like, these guys were in their 30s, maybe early 40s. So obviously they're a lot older now. So I think a part of it was like this random guy from South London just emails you and says he wants to talk to you about this period of your life. And you're sort of like, you know, getting on. Some of the guys, Peter Moore, Sonny Vaccaro, they're at peace with their legacy. They were more than welcome to sort of like
and
share
also,
these
people
things.
Don't often talk to them about their work because, you know, it's not the glamorous. They're their shoe designers or marketeers or, you know, they're illustrators. They're not like they were film stars or rock stars, you know.
Exactly.
So people quite like saying, yeah, I was involved in this pop cultural creation of a pop cultural icon that still, you know, lasts today. And your enthusiasm must have been very infectious. I loved also that you spent quite a lot of time on the Spike Lee relationship because I loved Spike Lee. And I remember, of course, when She's Got a Habit came out and when Do the Right Thing came out, they changed my life. But I also knew at the time that he did all these spots with Michael Jordan that we in the UK didn't get to see them. I just was like, I want to see all these things, you know. It was when I went to America for the first time in 1990, I was like, I've got to sit down and watch the Spike Lee's commercials because they were these kind of, and I get to, and I've seen them now in your film and it's so good. They're so good.
They're amazing, aren't they? I think Jim Riswald, who is actually the former sort of like executive who gave Spike Lee his job in terms of like directing those ads, I think he says they're the most groundbreaking, like, you know, sports ads ever made. And I think he's right. I think if you kind of look at everything that's come after it, it's tried to be as cool as tried to be as funny as those ads, you know, and they're effortless. And I think, you know, some of the contributors in the film talk about Michael Jordan doesn't talk a lot in those ads. That's all Spike. So he directed them and then he played the character of Mars Black Moon and just like killed it. So yeah, they were always my favorite ads, even before I started thinking about making this film. And I wanted it to sort of like be a little bit of a nostalgia trip to sort of like include them in the film, because a certain age group of people will remember those ads and remember sort of, you know, seeing them before NBA games, if you could sort of like get them, if you were able to see them. So yeah, I always love those ads. And
well, it comes across, and I'm really glad. I've never seen anyone, you know, and I've seen a lot of Spike retrospectives and talked to people who I've interviewed Spike many times myself, and we talk about Arsenal a lot, but we actually don't concentrate on what really, if you forget, what probably made his career. I mean, it probably made in terms of the general acceptance of him and his affiliation with this icon, but made him famous, but more than we know here in the UK.
100%. I think it's also fair to say that the brand owes a lot of credit to those ads and to Spike. This is sort of like a relationship that dates back 40 years. You know, he's been involved in that brand, and I think everyone would always sort of like point at those adverts. So yeah, I think you're right. I think it was vice versa. I think it worked for Spike, and I think it worked for the brand as well in terms of like recognition and like legacy.
I've got to touch on the fact that your film also touches on a dark side, which I thought was great. Did you always know that was where you were gonna kind of, you know, stamp down on this was a proper story, because it was about, you know, life and death?
100%. I, you know, because I remember being a teenager and remember hearing, because I was obsessed with rap music when I was a teenager, and I still am. And I, you know, I used to remember stories of kids on subways in New York City getting robbed for their Air Jordan sneakers. I used to remember those stories. So we wanted to tell the definitive story of the Air Jordan with this film. And I didn't feel that you could leave that part out. You know, I kind of felt that would have been a little bit disingenuous, and we didn't really want to rewrite history. We wanted to challenge it, and we wanted to probe it, and we wanted to examine it. So yeah, I always knew that we would include that in the film.
Well, I'm going to ask you, have you seen anything good lately, Yemi Bamiro?
I watched a Netflix documentary called Social Dilemma.
I don't know
if you've seen that.
No, I've seen it up there, and I've seen that maybe I should go into it, and then I'm so worried about what it's going to tell me about. Everyone's got my data.
I mean, it's pretty scary, but I did enjoy it. You know, I just, the fact that they've got all of those people from huge tech companies who no longer work there just telling you how they design this stuff and telling you what their sort of like objective was when they were designing it, basically to keep you on your phone, or to keep you on the app, or to keep you on that platform, is pretty scary. So yeah, I've watched that, and I'm also like rewatching Succession as well.
I have watched that. I watched the binge that at the beginning of lockdown, feels like months ago now. I just bought all two series, right? This is what we're going to do. I thought, fine, we'll do this, and then lockdown will finish and it'll be fine. It'll just fit in Succession. Little did I know. But, I mean,
it's just phenomenal.
I was hooked
on it. It's just incredible writing and acting. And yeah, I was just... I finished something and I was just like, I think I'm going to jump back in. I watched a documentary series called Dynasty, which was, I think, about Murdoch on the BBC. And that's what kind of like prompted me to rewatch Succession. So yeah, those are the things that I'm kind of have watched or am watching.
Obviously with your film, My Man in His Shoes, you, I think you do some of the music yourself. Is that right? Did I spot that in the credits there?
No. Like one of the collaborators, one of the sort of musicians is a friend of mine, composers, I should say. And yeah, I've known him for over 10 years and we always spoke about, you know, working together. So it was a pleasure for Thomas and Bubba to sort of like jump in and do all the music for the film.
Because he's got that vibe of 90s, hip-hop, if you want a little bit of jazz, and it could be a sample that I'm thinking is a sample they found something that the tribe used or something.
No, we couldn't afford any music. So it was all composed.
If you could have afforded some music, what would you have put in there?
Oh my God, like I would have gone crazy on Tribe. I would have gone crazy on Eric B and Rakim. I would have gone crazy on De La. I would have gone crazy on sort of like maybe Jungle Brothers. I would have gone crazy on Beastie Boys. I would have gone crazy on
What did you have on your temp track? You can put them on there, can't you?
Yeah. I think we had Eric B and Rakim. We had
Soul or
No, Don't Sweat the Technique. Yep. No, we went crazy with the temp music. It was so when we were like when we came to the composing the film, it was like so hard because like for like months we'd been staring and watching this film with all this incredible temp music, and then we had to sort of like just strip it back. But then that, you know, that's testament to how good like Bubba and Thomas did, the composers, because I think the first time we watched it with all of their music, we were like, oh my God, like we don't miss any of that. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, no, it was a good process.
Yeah, absolutely. And I didn't miss it either. I was thinking, I thought this is going to be full of 90s hip hop. Fantastic.
Yeah.
And then it wasn't. Yeah. And I thought, well, of course they couldn't afford it, but actually it doesn't miss it at all. They got the vibe of it. And actually probably better not for it. Otherwise it would just be like, you know, it would be too much fun.
I think so. Yeah. It was important just to get the tone and the vibe. So
if you could pick a Tribe track, which would you use?
I would Find a Way. So that's later Tribe. Yeah. So that's like maybe 96. Can I Kick It?
That goes for the Ian Wright.
Electric,
you can use that when you do your Ian Wright 90s football UK
thing. Yeah. So yeah, I love Tribe. So yeah, I think maybe those tracks.
Okay, Low End Theory is my favorite album of all time.
Oh my God, just heroes, man. They're just incredible masterpiece album.
Yemi Bamiro, fantastic talking 90s hip hop with you. Fantastic talking
Jason,
Michael Jordan.
Thank you so much.
Real pleasure. Yeah, and listen, enjoy the London Film Festival. I know it's the worst year that you could possibly make your debut at the London Film Festival, but I still think you and Michael can soar above this pandemic thing.
Thank you, Jason. Appreciate you. Thank you so much, man.
That's A Tribe Called Quest. Can I Kick It? Playing us out there. A request of kinds from Yemi Bamiro. And his film, One Man and His Shoes, is out in UK cinemas from October the 23rd. Great stuff, everyone. Lovely show. Lots of recommendations in there, and not least the great works of my guests, David Nicholls and Yemi Bamiro. But before we go, I have to tell you something else that I've seen. Mangrove. It was the opening film of the London Film Festival, and it would be wrong of me not to tell you how good it is. Definitely one of the best films I've seen this year, and a perfect opener to the London Film Festival. Steve McQueen is directing, and his meticulous reconstruction of the events around the raids on the Mangrove restaurant in Notting Hill, which after a street protest leads to the landmark trial of the Mangrove Nine, Vine in 1970. It's really brilliantly done. The actors Sean Parks, Letitia Wright, Malachi Kirby, who plays Dark as Hal, they're all brilliant. And the impeccable structure of the film is really something to admire, because McQueen gradually builds up these tensions and the threat to black life from police, while London in the background progresses onwards. The Grenfell Tower, you can see in the corner of one shot, the West Way is built, and he captures that with a bit of archive photography, all set to bouncing reggae music. And then the trial begins, and it's done perfectly, with the right amount of rage and injustice, but with a calm dignity that's really necessary. There's even a sense of humour, which is, I suppose, remarkable, given this was nothing funny about it. Institutional racism is never a laughing matter. It's just a monumentally good film. The best I can remember the LFF ever starting with, I can think. It's just perfect. What a shame that there were no big crowds to celebrate it, to mark it, to cheer it, and to bounce along a party afterwards to the rhythm of Toots and the Maytals. Still, we can pay tribute here on Seen Anything Good Lately, and it doesn't get better for British cinema than Steve McQueen's Mangrove. I'll see you next week as we go out with Pressure Drop by Toots and the Maytals from the Mangrove soundtrack.